Good morning, everyone, and may I welcome everyone to the first meeting in 2022 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, which is taking place fully online. And we have apologies today from our convener, Stuart McMillan, and in his place, can I welcome Jenny Minto, MSP. Welcome to you, Jenny. And before we move to the first agenda item then, as we're meeting online today, it will be more challenging for members to indicate agreement to the items being discussed, and we have had a bit of a talk about this, so therefore can you raise your hand if you're not content with the question being put or if you wish to speak about an instrument. And the first item of business is a declaration of interest, and in accordance with Section 3 of the Code of Conduct, I invite Jenny Minto, MSP, to declare any interest relevant to the remit of the committee. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener. I have no relevant interest to declare with regard to the remit of this committee. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. So the next item of business then is to decide whether to take item 8 in private. Is the committee content to take this item in private? Yep, no member has indicated that they're not content or that they wish to speak, and so we are agreed. That's item 8 will be taken in private. And moving to agenda item 3 today, we are taking evidence from John Swinney, MSP, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, on the committee's inquiry into the use of the made affirmative procedure during the coronavirus pandemic. The Deputy First Minister is accompanied by three Scottish Government officials, Rachel Rayner, SGLD Deputy Legislation Coordinator. Welcome to Rachel. Elizabeth Blair, Unit Head COVID Coordination. Elizabeth Blair. And Stephen McGregor, Head of the Parliament and Legislation Unit. And we welcome Stephen McGregor. So I welcome you all to the meeting, and we're very grateful that you're able to attend virtually today. So I remind once again all attendees not to worry about turning on their microphones during the session, as these will be controlled by broadcasting. So you don't have to worry about that at all. Now, just for the, I'm going to invite the Deputy First Minister to make some opening remarks, but just to let you know, Deputy First Minister, that's the procedure will be slightly different from the usual questioning today, in as much as it's been agreed that members will ask a series of questions, followed by then another member, then another, and then another. So it's not going to be back and forwards so much as it normally is. It's going to be a run of questions per member. And the first member, with his questions, Graham Simpson, please. Oh, sorry, beg your pardon, I do apologise. I'm so excited here. Can I first ask invite the Deputy First Minister to make some opening remarks, please? Deputy First Minister, thank you.
Hey, good morning, Convener, and I welcome the opportunity to give evidence this morning in relation to the committee's inquiry into the use of the made affirmative procedure. I've noted with interest the views expressed by previous witnesses, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to make a brief opening statement. In the past almost 2 years, and indeed very recently, the decisions we have taken in bringing forward regulations using the made affirmative procedure in relation to COVID SSIs have been based on the need to address the very serious threat posed by coronavirus. I can assure the committee that the government does not take lightly the use of the made affirmative procedure for these SSIs. The powers are exceptional powers, which have been required for the exceptional circumstances we find ourselves in. The made affirmative procedure has provided the government with necessary flexibility to deal with crisis situations when immediate action has been necessary. For example, when imposing or removing public health restrictions both domestically and in terms of international travel restrictions. It has also been necessary when urgent action has been required to deal with the continuing effects of the pandemic, and when that action has to be taken more quickly than the normal draft affirmative procedure allows for. The continuing need for this flexibility has been demonstrated clearly by the impact of the Omicron variant. In recognition of the exceptional nature of these powers, the Government is committed to working with Parliament to ensure that it can conduct effective scrutiny of COVID-related regulations. In the last session of Parliament, we agreed a process which ensured that the COVID-19 Committee was provided with a copy of the relevant draft made affirmative regulations and had an opportunity to consider these before they were brought into force. We've also sought to explore whether the normal draft affirmative procedure can be expedited in appropriate cases. Successfully, for example, the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Amendment No. 4 Regulations 2021. Convener, I recognise the concerns which have been expressed that the Government should not view use of the made affirmative procedure as a normal approach to legislating. I can assure the Committee that the Government shares that view. The Government did not, for example, make use of the power contained in the first Scottish Coronavirus Act convert any existing draft affirmative procedure into statute into the made affirmative procedure because of the impact of COVID. Indeed, that power has now been expired. Nor do I expect that the made affirmative procedure will become a more regular feature of future government legislation. It has its place, but only in a very limited set of circumstances. For example, for legislation dealing with the continued impact of the pandemic, such as the current compensation for self-isolation bill, or indeed relevant tax-related legislation. I hope the committee has found these remarks of help, and I'm very happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
Thank you very much indeed, Deputy First Minister. And I will now invite members to ask questions, and we will begin with Graeme Simpson, MSP. Graeme Simpson, please.
Thank you very much, Convener, and can I also welcome the Deputy First Minister to the meeting. I think we're all grateful that he's here, and I'm interested to hear what he's got to say. I note, Mr. Swinney, that you've brought three officials with you, and I wondered if I could start off by perhaps hearing from them, because they are the people that have to draft these laws. And it's been done at sort of breakneck speed a lot of the time. So I just wonder, before I question you, Mr. Swinney, if we might hear something from the officials about their experiences during the pandemic of having to make legislation at such great speed.
Deputy First Minister, is this all right with yourself?
Let me say a couple of words first, Convener, and then I'll hand over to my officials. I think the first thing I would say is that over the course of the pandemic, officials in the Scottish Government have had to work at pace across a whole range of different areas of policy and activity within the government's responsibilities. So working at pace has not been something that's been unique to this legislative team. The second point I would make is that I think Rachel Rayner perhaps will say a little bit more about this. The team, when ministers are considering what are the right steps to take, there will be, in most circumstances, a number of possibilities. And drafting is likely to take place across a range of those different possibilities before a concluded position is arrived at and then put into the draft instruments. So there is preparatory time for officials to be working on some of these questions before ministers take their final decisions. And I suppose, thirdly, we rely very heavily on the quality of drafting skills within government to prepare legislation of this type. I think generally that is of a very high quality and has been consistently demonstrated to be so. Obviously, when things are having to be done at pace, there is the potential for there to be errors made, which obviously we try to minimise. But our officials, in my opinion, do a tremendous job in making sure quality legislation can be produced in accordance with the circumstances with which we all wrestle at these times. But I'm very happy for my officials to add some remarks.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, on that basis,
perhaps Ms. Rayner might want to say something. Convener.
Rachel Rayner's name has been mentioned. Rachel Rayner, would you care to make a contribution here, please? Yeah. Microphone on. Ms. Rayner, your microphone available?
Yes. Thank you, convener. Lawyers have been very closely involved in the policy development process for all these COVID SSIs and have worked together very closely with policy colleagues. As the Deputy First Minister has indicated, we would often prepare contingent drafting for different options so that when decisions are made, drafting can be finalised as quickly as possible afterwards. We recognise that in the situation that we've been in, that decisions in relation to COVID need to be made with the most up-to-date data, and so preparing contingent drafting allows this to happen. And in addition, we have our usual checking process that's undertaken at the end of the drafting process to ensure that drafting maintains a high standard. Occasionally, issues will arise, and that can happen on non-COVID legislation as well. And where that does, you know, we would always consider it carefully and reflect on the issue and what can be done to avoid this happening in future.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Rayner. Graham Simpson, you're happy with that? Yep, thank you.
Thank you. Can I carry on, convener?
Yes, carry on. Yep.
Yes, thanks very much. I'll spare the officials from now on. They'll be pleased to hear. I noted the Deputy First Minister's comment that he doesn't want the use of the made affirmative procedure to become normal. Well, it has become normal. If we look at some figures, the made affirmative procedure was used since the start of session four up to the end of 2019 nine times. And then from the 20th of March 2020 and the 2nd of December 2021, it was used 132 times. Of those, most of those, the vast majority of those were coronavirus regulations. The percentage of those reported, generally for they could be mistakes, which is what this committee picks up on a lot of the time, is 11.6%. So that's quite a high number. So it has become normal, and it's become normal because the government has got into the habit of using this procedure, and it is a procedure. It has put in, if I can put it in layman's terms, and I'll just ask Mr. Swinney to respond to this once I've finished. You've been ramming through laws at breakneck speed with little to no oversight, and in my view, that is an affront to democracy. In fact, the Secondary Legislation Scrutiny Committee at Westminster called it government by diktat. I agree with that. And when retrospectively the laws do eventually come before Parliament, there's very little debate, and there's no procedure actually in this Parliament for a proper debate. So I think that's all that's very unsatisfactory. So I think my first question to Mr. Swinney would be, do you recognise the problem? And if you do recognise the problem, what do you intend to do about it?
Deputy First Minister.
Bluntly, convener, I don't recognise the problem, and I completely, utterly and unreservedly reject the ludicrous narrative that Graham Simpson has just put on the record. Mr. Simpson said that the made affirmative procedure had been used 9 times before the 20th of March 2020 and 132 times afterwards. That might have something to do with the fact that prior to the 20th of March 2020, under the life of the Scottish Parliament, we'd never faced a global pandemic. So, yes, there have been a lot of made affirmative instruments, but they have been required because of the necessity of acting quickly and swiftly in a public health emergency. And Mr. Simpson is one of a number of members of Parliament who regularly criticise me and my colleagues for bringing in a Westminster or a UK perspective to this debate. And Mr. Simpson has just done it himself because it suited him to do it. So I think what Mr. Simpson's question ignores is the reality of a public health pandemic. And if you look at the list of made affirmative instruments, there is a vast amount of them undertaken to put in place measures that were necessary to protect the public health of individuals in Scotland. And some of them related to international travel, which again was about trying to protect the public health of people in Scotland. Indeed, the 9 occasions in which the made affirmative procedure has been used prior to the 20th of March 2020, I think in a large number of circumstances, they were about public health requirements as well. So I totally reject the characterisation of this by Mr. Simpson. Now, in relation to parliamentary scrutiny, we've come to agreements with the Parliament and with committees about how added scrutiny can be given. There is always the opportunity for business managers of different parties to ask for more debating time on more questions. I wasn't handling all this legislation from 20th of March 2020 until the election. I've handled it since the election, but you know, I would be very happy to consider any requests for debates about legislation if members wished to have that in addition to what's provided for. But I think the starting point of all of this has to be an acceptance that there is a public health emergency that has to be addressed.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Mr. Simpson?
Yeah, I thank the Deputy First Minister for his comments. He described my comments as ludicrous. That's his view, then that's his view. But I did, of course, reference coronavirus in my opening comments. Quite clearly, that is the reason why the government has been using the made affirmative procedure. Nobody denies that. The question that this committee is addressing is moving on. Should that become a habit? And it has become a habit. And we've heard from various witnesses who've described it as a habit. Sir Jonathan Jones QC described it as a bad habit, and he said bad habits are hard to break. And I think not just this government, the Westminster government as well, this is a debate that's going on down there as well. They've also got into that habit. So the question for this parliament is, what do we do moving on? Because we don't want to, and I think the Deputy First Minister appeared to recognise that in his opening remarks, have this become the norm. Now, one of the issues that we've addressed while we've been taking evidence is the reality that in order for the made affirmative procedure to be used, all that needs to happen is that a minister, it could be Mr. Swinney himself, decides that something is urgent. They don't need to justify that. They don't need to come to Parliament and say why they think it's urgent. They just need to, in their own head, decide this is urgent, and with a flick of a ministerial pen, something becomes law. And there's no there's no scrutiny of that. So I'll put a question to Mr. Sweeney, which has come up in our evidence. Do you think, moving on, forgetting what's gone before, but moving on, should ministers have to come to Parliament, either the full Parliament or a committee, and justify why they think something is urgent?
Thank you. Deputy First Minister.
Yeah. I'll come on to answer the specific point that Mr. Simpson has put to me in a moment, but I do hope we're not going to go through a morning of my position and comments to committee being misrepresented by Mr. Simpson. In my opening remarks, I said, I recognise the concerns which have been expressed that the government should not view use of the made affirmative procedure as a normal approach to legislating. I can assure the committee that the government shares that view. This government has only used the made affirmative procedure as much as we have because of the global pandemic. It is not a default view of the government that this is the approach to legislating. It is a necessity of the incredibly difficult circumstances that we have faced and the need for us to act with urgency to protect the public. And I would point out that very substantial numbers of the orders put in place in the made affirmative procedure lapse and are not renewed simply because of the nature or the temporary nature of the provisions that are put in place. Now, Mr. Simpson indicates that alleges that the flick of a ministerial pen makes something law. Well, there is an element of substance in that view, but it stops being law if Parliament doesn't approve it within 28 days. So there's the parliamentary control and protection. Parliament doesn't like it, doesn't have to approve it. In relation to the question of the definition of urgency, I've seen the representations from the Law Society, amongst others, on this question, the Law Society of Scotland. I think it's a reasonable point. If it would help the create greater reassurance, I think ministers could readily make a statement of arguments for urgency, and that could be made to a committee, provided it still enables the government to act with urgency and doesn't undermine the principle that the law provides for the made affirmative procedure. And I should point out that the use of the made affirmative procedure under the coronavirus legislation was by virtue of an act of the United Kingdom Parliament and not an act of this Parliament. And some of the early examples of the use of the made affirmative procedure under the years of devolution is as a product of the utilisation of pre-devolution United Kingdom legislation in relation to a good quality and hygiene, which of course has been reserved legislation under which we are operating within the rule of law. It's really important that it's recognised that the made affirmative procedure is part of the legal firmament of the United Kingdom, and obviously where we are entitled to use that power, we are free to do so. If that would be enhanced in the committee's eyes by the provision of a statement of urgency, I'm very happy for that.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And Mr. Simpson again, please.
Thank you very much. I think that would be helpful if there was a statement. I think it would be even more helpful if Parliament was allowed to take a view on that, but I suppose having a statement would be a good first step, at least having ministers justify their position. Where we had the recent case where the vaccine passport scheme was introduced, in fact, this committee took a view on that. It had been planned and trailed for several weeks, And yet it was put through under the made affirmative procedure. So, you know, our view was that it wasn't, you couldn't say that that was urgent because it had been planned for weeks. So I think you know, that was a good example recently of why justifying your view that something is urgent is important. In terms of parliamentary oversight, I mean, the Deputy First Minister says Parliament gets a vote. Parliament does get a vote, but it's only after the law has come into effect. And my view is that's the wrong way round. And I think a lot of the time now that we could be using different procedures. It doesn't always have to be made affirmative. Parliament could take a view before something comes into law. So I suppose, as a general question, I would ask the Deputy First Minister if he agrees that more of these regulations could be put through using the affirmative procedure, which would allow Parliament to vote on things before they become law.
Thank you, Graeme Simpson. Deputy First Minister, and just to say, DFM, if there is at any point you want to bring any of your officials in, then you're at liberty to do so. Thank you.
I will, of course, do so, Convener. I think the question here really hinges on the question of urgency, because generally the made affirmative procedure, the affirmative procedure essentially relies on, we budget within government on that requiring 54 days to be able to be, to be confident that legislation can be enacted. So there's a world of a difference between a timetable of 54 days and the requirement to act, for example, to apply international travel restrictions or to apply some other form of regulated instrument around the opening hours of hospitality, as we've had to do recently. In the circumstances where urgent action is required, we cannot wait 54 days to do that. So I suppose my response would be, I'd be interested to hear what the committee suggests in this respect. If the choice is between a made affirmative procedure that enables us to act urgently to protect public health and an affirmative procedure which takes 54 days, I'm afraid I'm going to come down on the side of made affirmative, because the decisions the government has had to arrive at have been decisions that have had a material impact on the protection of life and limb. And the timescales that are normally associated with affirmative regulations, frankly, don't allow for that. So I think I'm very open to looking at how these measures can be enhanced. We took predecessor in handling these issues, Michael Russell, came to pragmatic agreements with the COVID-19 committee around the making available of regulations in draft so they could be discussed and questions could be asked about them at the routine meetings of the COVID-19 committee before they were enacted. These were obviously pragmatic measures to try to enhance the way in which the legislative system could operate, but I'm very happy to consider what else comes out of the committee.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And Graeme Simpson, I'm afraid I have to draw you. I can let you in for just one last word.
Yes, I'm aware of taking up quite a bit of time, Convener. I'm very grateful for that. I completely agree with the Deputy First Minister. You don't want to be having to wait 54 days to put through regulations that have a certain degree of urgency about them. So I think it's a question of Parliament being flexible, perhaps coming up with a bespoke procedure. And I think I'll leave my comments there because I know that other members will have things to say. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. Thank you for answering those questions, Deputy First Minister. And can we move To Craig Hoy, MSP, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Deputy First Minister, and welcome to you and your officials. If we could step back maybe from the pandemic for a moment and just think in a slightly more abstract sense, do you think that the increased use of skeleton legislation and the use and the widespread and now relatively common use of delegated powers within them is consistent with the need for parliamentary scrutiny and accountability?
Deputy First Minister.
Just before I answer that question, can I just ask Mr. Hoy, there was a slight interruption in the line and I just missed what I think was a pretty crucial word in this question. Was this question predicated on delegated legislation?
Firstly, in terms of the skeleton legislation and then the delegated legislation that stems from that, do you think that's consistent with the need for parliamentary scrutiny and accountability?
Yes, I'm glad I asked for clarification because I had, in fact, misheard the word. So it's skeleton legislation and delegated powers. I think this is a question that I think has to be considered on a case by case basis in relation to individual legislative instruments. Now, obviously, there can be arguments for skeleton primary legislation that requires to be completed by delegated legislation. If I give Mr. Hoy a real live example, Parliament in the last session legislated for the legislation on the redress scheme in relation to historic abuse. Now, that was pretty detailed legislation, but there were certain elements of it were left to be followed up by regulation. Now, and it was in relation to particular points of detail about, one of the particular issues I wrestled with recently in the secondary legislation was about remedying errors that had been made. Now, when I saw the detail of that legislation, of the secondary legislation, I balked because I thought there was an immense amount of detail in that secondary legislation, and I wrestled with how Parliament would react to that, having had extensive discussions about the redress legislation. But I think when I looked at it and thought about it and discussed it with my legal advisers and with officials, there was such detail required in that secondary legislation that to have put that on the face of the bill as primary legislation would have made for a colossal amount of detail more than ordinarily would be on the face of primary legislation to be in place. So I think it's important that we wrestle with these questions on a case-by-case basis. I think what I would say is an absolute requirement is that there must be a clear argument made for anything that may be described as skeleton legislation to be put in place, and a clear justification for that, which of course must satisfy the test of parliamentary scrutiny when the legislation is being considered.
Thank you, DFM. Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Convener. So, Deputy First Minister, would you concede that it's unhealthy to go down the route of having very broad brush legislation that then effectively allows you, the ministers, freed from the constraints of parliamentary scrutiny, to then flesh out those regulations and those laws?
Well, ultimately, Parliament must decide what it judges to be appropriate to be the contents of legislation. That's what we're all here for. There's 129 of us here as legislators, and we must decide through a very detailed process of scrutiny what is appropriate to put on the face of legislation and what is appropriate to put in secondary legislation. I think I'd counsel Mr. Hoy away from some of the terminology that he has used in his question, because even where ministers have got to are given delegated powers under secondary to act in secondary legislation, still got to bring that back to Parliament, and Parliament's got to scrutinise that. under different procedures, I acknowledge, but that still has to be scrutinised. And of course, there is, you know, legislation over many, many years is delegated. If I go back to legislation which underpins many aspects of the operation of our public services, the executive power of ministers has been an implicit part of that legislation by parliamentary design, not in the last year, 2 years, 5 years, but over the last 50 years, 70 years. So there's, I think that the question that's wrestled with here that Mr. Hoy puts to me is a question that Parliament has to wrestle with on every piece of legislation. And I think what and Parliament has to be satisfied that there is a robust case for legislating in the terms that it finally agrees to do so.
Obviously, the inquiry is looking specifically at the use of made affirmative, and I think the committee has general concerns about the use of delegated legislation more widely. But obviously, the fundamental element of the made affirmative is that the scrutiny comes after the law is introduced and implemented. So can you say, what was it about COVID passports that made you determine that it was an emergency situation and that it had to be introduced under the made affirmative?
The simple reason and rationale was the belief that vaccine certification would be a valuable tool in boosting the levels of vaccination, participation in the vaccination programme amongst key groups within our society, and that that would help us to protect public health. And there was a necessity to make as swift progress as we could make on the vaccination programme to enable that to be the case. And of course, what has been, I think, an integral part of the strategy to protect the public from COVID, it has been the effective participation within the vaccination programme. So pushing and driving the participation in that programme was an absolute necessity.
But it was a major change with quite wide-reaching implications. So you'd obviously thought about it for a long time, and then you subsequently delayed the enforcement. So you could quite rightly conclude that it wasn't an emergency, couldn't you?
No, because we put it into force to enable participation within the scheme, so that we could ensure that there was, we encouraged as much as possible higher uptake of the vaccination, and as a consequence, protected public health. So that the rationale for urgency, which I've just shared with Mr. Hoy, was the rationale that governed the approach that we took to the bringing forward of that of that instrument.
I would perhaps challenge that and maybe take up Mr. Simpson's point, which is that I think it could be perceived to be an example of the government getting into bad lawmaking habits here, where regulations are published too late and with undue scrutiny. And I think if you look at the evidence from the Children's Commissioner, the submission from them, they make that specific point that in their submission, they say that too often the regulations are published too late. And they say that it's not always clear that such short notice for publication was necessary, or that it was not possible for parliamentary scrutiny to have taken place in advance. That's a pretty fair criticism, isn't it?
No, it's not, because I've read the Children's Commissioner's evidence, and I don't think it's criticism that's warranted, because the government has a duty to protect public health, and on countless occasions we have had to exercise that duty, and to exercise it swiftly to protect the public. And I don't have the luxury of waiting for, to quote the example of the normal process of affirmative orders of 54 days. I don't have the luxury of waiting for that when there is a clamour, when I have advice in front of me to take action which is justified and proportionate to protect public health. I don't have the luxury of waiting 54 days to consider that. I've got to move. Yes, to be accountable. Of course I'm accountable for it, and if Parliament doesn't like it, it can vote against the orders 28 days within a 28-day period. These options are all available to Parliament, and I'm accountable for all of that. But it's a but you know, the luxury of having lots of time on my hands is not a luxury that I have when dealing with these difficult issues.
I think one of the concerns is obviously that we have to take government's word for it, and we have to take you at face value. And I'm not making a specific point in relation to you, Minister, because I think the same criticism has been levelled to the UK government in terms of its increased use of the made affirmative. And I would just use as an example of the Manchester travel ban, which came and went before Parliament could have rejected it had they thought it was not sound. But just to move on to a remark, perhaps just be interesting to get your reflections on, from Lord Lisvain, who you might have known from your time at Westminster, who is the former clerk of the House of Commons, who in a recent House of Lords debate said that the real losers through the made affirmative process are citizens and business, because in his words, and I quote, "They in industry, our national institutions and civil society need to know how the law will be changed, to have the opportunity to comment and make representations, and to know how it will end up applying to them." Thinking about the Manchester example, for example, isn't that a fair comment?
Well, obviously it's an interesting comment, but again, I put it into the same category that I put the Children's Commissioner's comments, that it doesn't really acknowledge the pressing urgency of action in a public health emergency. You know, I go back to one of my comments in my opening remarks and my comments to Mr. Simpson earlier on. I don't think the made affirmative procedure should be used habitually within the legislative process. Indeed, as Mr. Simpson helpfully pointed out, it's been used 9 times between the 1st of July 1999 and the 20th of March 2020. And those 9 examples, I have some of them in front of me, are for absolutely justifiable reasons, in my view, not exercised by me, exercised by my predecessors as ministers in other political administrations, but they acted, in my view, appropriately on those questions. But I don't think it's a procedure that should be used in the ordinary sphere of life. But if you're dealing with a global pandemic with very serious material threats to the life of individuals, of our citizens, then I'm afraid we have to act. Yes, there are opportunities for parliamentary challenge about these questions. I don't think there's been any lack of opportunity for people to raise their concerns about any issues within Parliament over the last, in the period since March 2020. First Minister has been making statements virtually weekly since 2020. The ability for members to raise issues. Committees have been meeting. There's been a bespoke COVID committee. Endless opportunities for people to raise issues. In relation to awareness of legislation, yes, there is a need for people to be aware of legislation, and obviously if it changes abruptly, we have to take steps to make sure that's communicated. The government does that. We try to make that available as widely as we possibly can do. And obviously we're very open to listening to how we might enhance that process.
Just one final question, if I may, Convener. There is still an underlying concern here that government in general perhaps has used COVID and the pandemic to do what government often quite likes to do, which is to take decisions free from as much scrutiny of Parliament as it possibly can. So Jonathan Jones QC suggested to us that perhaps one solution here would be for every and each piece of delegated law to be brought by the Minister to the floor of Parliament. For even brief consideration and debate, could be 10 or 15 minutes, given that a lot of it is relatively uncontentious. But that would then mean that the legislation, that delegated legislation, is questioned and subject to scrutiny. wouldn't that overcome the view that, that you do have something to hide and that you are running from scrutiny in respect of certain regulations?
Deputy First Minister.
No, I think this is frankly, obviously Mr Hoy and Mr Simpson have decided this is going to be the ludicrous line of argument that they deploy. There is plenty of scrutiny of the government, and if they, there's going to be a statement this afternoon from the First Minister where she will take 40 minutes of questions from members of Parliament in relation to her statement this afternoon. So the idea that this government is not under scrutiny about on COVID is just ludicrous.
Wouldn't you perhaps argue that the somewhat intemperate and bad-tempered response to legitimate questions does prove my point that you aren't overly happy with parliamentary scrutiny at the moment?
There's nothing intemperate about me, Mr. Hoy. I'm simply pointing out the absurdity of the point that you and Mr. Simpson are putting to me this morning. There is endless opportunity for parliamentary scrutiny of all of these issues. There is the statement the First Minister gives. I am, or one of my ministerial colleagues, is in front of the COVID Recovery Committee every week, and have been on a constant basis. Other committees are interrogating ministers. There has been extensive the coronavirus legislation. I appreciate Mr. Hoy wasn't in the Parliament when that was put through in 2020. Two very extensive pieces of legislation put through Parliament, scrutinised by members of Parliament. So, I'm not in any way concerned about scrutiny. I submit myself to parliamentary scrutiny on a constant basis. But what I think is frankly ludicrous is the kind of argument that Mr. Hoy puts to me this morning. Now, in relation to the suggested alternative of a 15-minute debate on the floor of Parliament, firstly, I think that would attract the charge of tokenism, to be honest. I think also the point Mr. Hoy himself just made the point that that might be satisfactory because most of this material is, I think he used the word non-contentious. Well, if it's non-contentious, then I think that perhaps undermines the argument that Mr. Hoy has put to me, that if actually members of Parliament generally see this as legislation that has to happen to protect public health and it is non-contentious in nature, then surely that makes my argument for me that the made affirmative procedure is the appropriate procedure for this to be undertaken. If there are issues of a cumulative nature that arise out of the legislation, then of course those can be resolved, and they can be resolved by further scrutiny. But it does indicate that perhaps a mountain has been made out of a molehill on some of these issues.
I think just finally, just to pick up on that point, I think the element in our committee finds this is that a lot of what comes before us isn't necessarily contentious, but by having that process of scrutiny, it would give Parliament and the public the reassurance that things aren't going through that should be subject to a rigorous process of scrutiny, wouldn't we?
And I think what we're all agreed on here is the need to make sure there is appropriate parliamentary scrutiny of the any legislative instruments that are coming forward. And I think that's vitally important in all scenarios. But I'm simply making the argument that if we are to look dispassionately at what has happened in relation to legislation since March 2020, most of what has been brought forward under the made affirmative procedure has been essential, non-contentious material that has been required to protect the public in a public health emergency. And I appreciate there's a difference of view about vaccine certification. I understand that philosophical difference of view within members of Parliament. But then on countless other measures that have gone through with unanimity across the political spectrum, there is, I take from that, there is an acceptance by members of Parliament of all political persuasions of the validity and the necessity of individual pieces of legislation.
Okay. Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister, and thanks very much to Craig Hoy. I'm afraid my computer fell out a bit there, actually, so I missed some of the excitement in the past 20 minutes. But I think we can move on now. Thanks very much, Craig Hoy. Can move on now to Paul Sweeney, MSP, please.
Thank you, Convener. It's been an interesting discussion so far, and I think this inquiry actually itself, whilst initially might have appeared on the face of it quite a dry exercise, has actually been really interesting, certainly for me as a new MSP, just looking at the broader historical issues. So some of our witnesses have described the broad trends of the tension between the executive and the legislature over decades, being a source of contention, which has been an interesting sort of thing to reflect on. And obviously we've seen this recent change in the manner in which the government is legislating by using the made affirmative procedure, so bringing forward a large amount of made affirmative procedures. I'd just like to ask the Deputy First Minister, based on his experience as an opposition and government member, looking at how this has played out in the last 2 years or so, how do you feel the made affirmative procedure has worked in terms of the quality of the measures introduced? Obviously, we're aware of the necessity of them and requirements of speed. But on reflection, are you aware of any incidences where this may have led to things going awry for want of greater scrutiny or greater patience and looking at how the actual practical implications of these measures were actually going to work?
Thank you for that. Deputy First Minister, please.
Thank you, Convener. And I would recognise that in any legislative process, slow or quick, there is always the potential for errors to be made. And sometimes we find ourselves, I use we in the generic as of government ministers over all time, that provisions can be put in place in a stage one draft of a bill, and you find during the passage of the bill that there's an error with it or a mistake's been made, and you know, you've got opportunities to remedy that, to have to remedy it at stages two or three. So errors can be made. I don't think process or the people involved in it are infallible. And I think generally, we are fortunate in having very high levels of quality in the drafting of legislation. And I think we're also served well by Parliament and parliamentary officials in the way in which they scrutinise and highlight any issues that arise around about legislation. So I think that interaction between government and Parliament is helpful and welcome and adds to the process. And obviously the scrutiny by members of Parliament assists in the process, but there is obviously that you know, nobody is infallible. Obviously, when you move at such pace, the risk of error increases, but I think we have minimised that in the process of what has been a necessary use of the made affirmative procedure, but not a habitual use of the made affirmative procedure in terms of our future actions as a government.
And Paul Sweeney.
Hey, I mean, certainly, thanks for that answer. And I think there's a broad reflection to add, not just on the made affirmative procedure, but certainly some of our witnesses have argued that, you know, adequate scrutiny of the primary legislation is a key part of the robustness as well. Professor Tierney, for example, mentioned that the real problems are not simply with the made affirmative procedure downstream, but with the fact that primary legislation that created the powers itself was drafted and passed very quickly without adequate scrutiny. And I think, you know, if you look at how these then pile up and you have a situation where the actual initial legislation becomes so distorted that it's hard to actually understand what it has any meaning for parliamentarians or members of the public. Certainly witnesses have discussed the accessibility of instruments which have been the subject of multiple amendments. So Sir Jonathan Jones QC and the Law Society have both suggested that the publication of consolidated versions of instruments which have been the subject of multiple amendments would be a good improvement to the current procedures. So is that something that you might consider introducing? Is it something that the government might take away and reflect on in terms of improving the transparency and what the implications are when you have multiple changes to legislation, so there's greater understanding of actually what it means despite all those changes?
Deputy First Minister.
Thanks, Convener. I think the first thing I'd say, Mr. Sweeney, is that the current situation is not my ideal model of how we should legislate. We should always take care and time over legislation. Indeed, this Parliament, I think, has very good procedures in place for ensuring that is the case. But we, as Mr. Sweeney acknowledges, we're dealing with a necessity of acting swiftly here. So the process does require us to act in that fashion. I think in relation to the question of accessibility of legislation, I'm conscious of the challenge that this has represented to different individuals and to different groups. And I'd be happy to consider whether there is a way that we could improve and enhance any of the arrangements that are in place so that the marshalling of that legislation is more accessible and more visible. And the website legislation.gov.uk has been ensuring that COVID regulations are updated as soon as possible, after they're amended, which gives a sort of consolidated place where that legislation is available. But I accept also that that can, by its nature, it's a very helpful website, but it is, it's complex. But legislation itself is complex. But I'm certainly willing to give some further consideration to the points that witnesses have raised and which Mr. Sweeney puts to me, which I think are may well help us in taking this issue forward.
Thank you. I think that's useful. And Paul Sweeney.
Yeah, I'd just also like to follow up on that with you mentioned that you attend the COVID-19 committee relatively frequently, and I think that's a fair point about how the Parliament interacts with the executive and holding to account, particularly under such unusual circumstances. However, in its submission to our committee, the COVID-19 Recovery Committee has suggested that the affirmative procedure, as opposed to the made affirmative procedure, as a more default measure, would enable the committee to gather views from affected stakeholders before proposed policy changes are made into the law. This process is an essential part of the committee's role in delivering the Scottish Parliament's mission statement to create good quality, effective and accessible legislation. And furthermore, we've also had some evidence about the idea of greater parliamentary scrutiny ahead of these measures coming into force. So it was suggested that we actually have a parliamentary debate that's fairly regular, that would enable greater discussion and comment upon regulations and questions to the Minister on the use of the made affirmative procedure. So the idea would be that there'd be a regular parliamentary time allotted clearly to discuss publicly made affirmative procedures, because I guess certainly when you're making statements in Parliament, they're very general and it can't necessarily, by nature of them, hone in on the technicalities, some of these issues that are debated in made affirmative procedures. So perhaps would it be something that the government might consider looking at parliamentary time and the parliamentary timetable to actually make more specific parliamentary time in the chamber available for close scrutiny and discussion of made affirmative procedures before they're brought into force?
Thank you, Kevin. I think that's very happy to consider that point, although I would say that I view myself very much in this respect as the servant of Parliament on this question. And if Parliament wishes to exercise more scrutiny, to ask me to be available to answer more questions on measures that are going through in the made affirmative procedure, then if Parliament asks me to do something, providing it's within the law, I will do it. I'm a servant of Parliament. I've made it clear to the COVID-19 committee that, with providing there's reasonable notice, I will appear in front of them at any time, because I view that to be my primary channel of parliamentary accountability. So these are issues, very fair and reasonable issues that Mr. Sweeney puts to me. If the Parliamentary Bureau was to consider them in relation to the parliamentary timetable, or committees were to decide to act in a particular way, then I am the servant of Parliament in that respect. So I would be entirely happy to participate in such an approach.
Thank you. And Paul Sweeney, is that okay?
Thanks very much. Appreciate that response, and perhaps that's something the committee can consider. I suppose if we're looking at the continuous improvement of the Parliament and its procedures, that's something to consider. Just more generally, there was discussion earlier about skeleton bills and how that kind of form of legislation has become an increasingly attractive trend for government, because it allows a sort of broad general principles to be outlined, but there's not necessarily the clear specific actions detailed in the legislation, and it leaves a lot of leeway subsequently for ministers to sort of direct where they want to go through secondary legislation, and that perhaps presents some complications. So one example that springs to mind is the 2019 Transport Act, which had a number of amendments made to, for example, on introduction of franchising, local authorities setting up their own municipal bus companies, and also bus service improvement partnerships, which are a general sort of public-private partnership model, which is a bit more light touch, more akin to the status quo of the deregulated model. Even though all those provisions were provided in the legislation, effectively the government and Transport Scotland, the agency, have only really resourced and pushed forward on the bus service improvement partnerships, and the other options for local authorities to pursue aren't actually resourced in any meaningful way. So it's an example of where legislation was fleshed out in a skeleton sense, but actually how it's implemented and driven by secondary legislation means that a lot of the provisions in legislation aren't actually taken forward. So I wonder more generally, the government might want to reflect on skeleton bills, how they're designed, that's been a long-term trend across governments for decades, and whether it leads to sort of problematic issues later on, where there's Parliament's expressed a view that things should happen in the country, yet in reality they don't actually happen. What would the Deputy First Minister think about that just general principle, about some of the problems that we're seeing with the tendency to use skeleton bills, and then we see lots of provisions that are put in place not actually taken forward in secondary legislation?
I don't think there's an increasing trend to use skeleton legislation. Except there's some skeleton legislation put forward, yeah, of course. I don't think there's an increasing trend. And I think it does come down to one of the answers I gave earlier on to Craig Hoy, which is about judging this on a case-by-case basis. If I go back to that legislation that I talked about in my answer to Mr. Hoy about the redress scheme, I suppose I could have brought forward a bill which said, Parliament will legislate for a redress scheme and ministers will decide what the redress scheme should be. Now, that would have been very skeletal legislation. I think that would have been wholly inappropriate, because there were some big issues had to be determined about the nature of the redress scheme, and Parliament decided all of those questions. And some of the detail that underpins those big questions is left to secondary legislation, I accept, but I wouldn't in any shape or form describe the Redress Scotland Bill as skeleton legislation. Indeed, I wouldn't describe the Transport 2019 legislation as skeleton legislation either. I think there's accept that there are provisions that require either executive action or secondary legislation, but I think Parliament will have decided on the key questions that should be applied there. I think there is always a tension about, or a debate about, what's the appropriate level of detail to be on the face of a bill. And I think Parliament, frankly, agonises about that with every piece of legislation. And there will be voices that will say there's far too much detail here. There'll be voices that say, there's far too much detail here because it runs the risk of becoming inflexible, versus there's far too little legislation, far too little detail here. It therefore remains vague and gives far too much power to ministers. So there's a spectrum there. that I think Parliament has to wrestle with, and I think it has to wrestle with that on a case-by-case basis. I was trying to get at my answers to Mr. Hoy earlier on, and I would give a similar kind of response to Mr. Sweeney just now. I don't think there's a precise model that you can say is appropriate in all circumstances, because in certain circumstances, indeed, a Member of Parliament may decide, you know, to pursue an issue, and I've seen this on countless occasions, where if you look at a bill as a whole, a particular provision in it looks significantly more detailed and focused than every other clause in the bill. But that's because a Member of Parliament has made it their business to try to get something of that specificity into the bill for a particular purpose. I don't criticise it, I admire it. That is the use of the parliamentary procedure to make something happen. Members of Parliament should be entitled to do so. And so that I think is open to Members of Parliament. I think there's also a kind of wider philosophical debate. Mr. Sweeney's right about this. It's been going on for all my lifetime, and before that, about what's the right balance between specificity and flexibility within legislation. And a lot of that hinges on what's the level of executive power and responsibility that's granted by Parliament in every circumstance.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Paul Sweeney, for the questions. I think they're very helpful to open things out there, same as previous questions. And thank you to the DFM. Jenny Minto, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Deputy First Minister, for joining us today. Like Mr. Sweeney, I'm a new member of this Parliament and new to the committee, so I found this morning's discussion very, very informative, and also the evidence that was submitted also very useful. I'd like to turn back to the objectives of what this review has been on, and part of it is to help ensure that there's an appropriate balance between flexibility for the government in responding to an emergency situation while still ensuring appropriate parliamentary scrutiny and oversight. Now, I wasn't a Member of Parliament when the pandemic all started, and I was very clear that what was so important to me was clarity of law, how it affected my life and how the public health emergency was being addressed. And it's been said in evidence to the committee that perhaps it was easier for us to legislate to go to lockdown than to start emerging from it. So I'm interested to hear, Deputy First Minister, what you've learnt from this experience and how you think it can shape the future decision making within the Parliament and the use of using the made affirmative procedures.
Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Convener. I think, first of all, what I would say is that I think Parliament has some very, very strong procedures around how it goes through the creation of new legislation. I think our processes are very transparent, they're engaging, they give adequate time and opportunity for scrutiny. That's not to say they can't be enhanced, but generally I think Parliament has some pretty strong, transparent procedures around the formulation of legislation. And for that reason, I think we should use the mechanisms that Parliament has, which is why I come back to my comments in my opening remarks that, you know, the government really doesn't want to make a habit of using the made affirmative procedure, because it doesn't actually allow all the time that our other procedures allow for engagement, consultation and scrutiny in advance of legislation being enacted. But the necessity of the public health emergency has required the use of the made affirmative procedure. So I think the Parliament, I think, is well served by the arrangements that it has in place. But it also, I think, has recognised with pragmatism the necessity of acting swiftly to put in place mechanisms and measures for the handling of the public health emergency. Indeed, Jenny Minto's predecessor as Member of Parliament for Argyll and Bute, Michael Russell, was the author of the coronavirus legislation within Parliament and steered that legislation through Parliament and presided over much of the scrutiny of the measures as a consequence of that in the last parliamentary session, and did so with great distinction. Because there was a necessity for us to act in those circumstances to ensure we had measures in place that could protect the public. And these are the questions with which we wrestle at all times. What is the right approach to take? Generally, I think the arrangements the Parliament has in place habitually are the appropriate measures to take. In the circumstances of a global pandemic that requires swift action, then I think the measures that have been taken are appropriate. But I think we should always be open to learning lessons from that, and obviously the government will consider with care any output that comes from the committee's inquiry in this process.
Minto, please. Jenny.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I think some of the evidence that I read talked about when you're setting up, or when you're describing or giving a definition of what an urgency is, but also what an emergency is, then there's a lot of there has to be some personal input into that. So I'm interested to know how you personally weighed up what you felt was urgent and also what was an emergency.
I think this has been an incredibly challenging period, and it revolves around essentially the wrestling with that very question. And I've wrestled with it on countless occasions. If I give an example, a year ago, just around about this time last year, Parliament rose, if my memory serves me right, on the 22nd of December 2020. And we, as a group of ministers, we met that evening at the end of the parliamentary session, and our judgment around the state of the pandemic was that we felt it was in a reasonably stable situation. A week later, we reconvened to deal with the emergency Brexit legislation. So I may have my dates, they might not be absolutely correct, but it was around about the 29th or the 30th of December. And we reconvened. Once we did the Brexit legislation, we gathered again and just where we thought things were at, and we were slightly more concerned about the situation, but we felt it was still we had the right measures in place. By the end of New Year's Day, the 1st of January 2021, I was on conference calls with other ministers being briefed about a rapidly deteriorating situation. So much so, the presiding officer called Parliament on the 4th of January 2021 to hear from the First Minister and for us to enact very restrictive measures on people's freedom of movement and activity with immediate effect, which was the subject of the made affirmative procedure. Now, there we have an example of where I would say in the space of 40 hours, the patient deteriorated dramatically and necessitated urgent intervention. If I give another example, and this has been vividly in my mind very recently, and the Cabinet met on the 23rd of November 2021, and our view generally was that the situation was relatively stable, and we felt that we had a reasonably sustainable pathway through the Christmas and New Year period. On the 25th of November, we were called to a briefing to be advised of the early findings of the research in South Africa on Omicron. And by that night, my colleague, Mr. Matheson, was on a United Kingdom call putting in place travel restrictions around South Africa and various southern African states. And so we'd quite literally gone from thinking on a Tuesday morning, indeed Parliament had been advised on a Tuesday afternoon by the First Minister, of our view that we were in a relatively stable position, to a position of acute concern by the Thursday. So in my book, that's why urgent action is required, because the situation has changed before our eyes in very dramatic order and fashion. And I think that's necessitated action of the speed and the pace that the government has taken.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. Thank you, Convener.
And thank you very much, Jenny Minto. And we've got one quick follow-up question from Graeme Simpson here on the back of this.
Yeah, thanks again, Convener. I just want to ask Mr. Swinney about something else that's been raised by witnesses to the committee, but we haven't covered it yet, and that's the idea that we should introduce sunset provisions, both in primary legislation and secondary legislation. I just wonder what your thoughts are on that.
Thank you. First Minister, thank you.
On obviously, in relation to primary legislation, Parliament is at liberty to apply sunset provisions if it judges them to be appropriate. And by their nature, many of the statutory instruments that have been introduced in relation to the handling of COVID through the made affirmative procedure have sunset provisions in them already. Indeed, you know, a large number of them have expired of their own free will. So there is a role for sunset provisions, and if that in relation to much of the made affirmative procedure, you know, there is a sunsetting provision implicit in that if Parliament doesn't vote for the legislation within 28 days, it lapses. So there is that provision there already. I think obviously there's a role for this, and the government would be happy to consider these measures and possibilities as part of the legislative process.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Right, thank you very much indeed for that. Okay, I think we've reached our stage now. okay, so I would like to thank the Deputy First Minister and the officials, Elizabeth Blair, Steve McGregor, and on this occasion most particularly Rachel Rayner, who had to make some comments there, and they were very helpful. So I'd like to thank you all for helpful evidence, and just to add that the committee, as has been suggested, may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the meeting, if that will be suitable, Deputy First Minister. Thank you.
Information required.
Right, okay. Thank you very much for that. That's very kind. Okay, so the questions are exhausted. No doubt the Deputy First Minister is as well, so thank you very much indeed, and we'll see you again. Okay, thank you, and I'll suspend the meeting for a few minutes just to allow the witnesses to leave blue jeans, and we've got one or two wee things I've got to actually get sorted out at this end as well, so thank you. Well, hi everyone. Thank you very much indeed for your patience during the suspension of the meeting there. So we're moving on now under agenda item 4, and we're considering instruments subject to the made affirmative procedure. So no technical points have been raised on SSIs 2021 475, 478, 496, 497 and 498. However, I can invite any comments from members on the instrument, and I believe that Graeme Sampson had a comment first of all, please.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I can comment on them all. So we've got regulations 475, 478, 496, 497, 498. 478, which we'll come to, I don't think is contentious. I won't be saying a great deal on that. That relates to there was a technical issue in the chamber where MSPs were unable to vote on a previous regulation, and therefore it expired and this has been relayed. So that happened, that's out of the way. The other regulations, however, I take a different view. They relate to the regulations that came in over the Christmas, over the festive period, shall we say, in relation to leisure, sporting events, theatres, pubs, nightclubs. They relate to those. So that's what all these four regulations do, and I think members of the public and indeed the people involved in those sectors know very well what happened. And in fact, you know, we had the closing down of sporting events. The football calendar, certainly in the Premiership, was Premier League, was put on pause. We don't know whether. My view is that the use of the made affirmative procedure, which we've just been discussing, for these regulations was not appropriate, and they could have benefited, and they would have benefited by some scrutiny. They had no scrutiny. So I think the affirmative procedure, and Parliament could have made time for that. We have acted at pace at times previously. I think the affirmative procedure would have been a better procedure in these instances. So I would be moving against them on that basis, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Graeme Sampson, and Paul Sweeney, please.
Thank you, convener. I think on reflection, having read through the clerk's documentation on this and actually the real life implications of some of the measures that were brought in over the festive period, for example, I've had constituents come to me over the Christmas period from Ambassador Theatre Group, for example, who have had short notice cancellations of their productions over Christmas, pantomimes at the King's Theatre, for example. But the upshot of it has been that because of the insufficient specification of support to that sector, it's meant that employees have been basically left with up to 5 weeks without pay in January, which is a pretty horrendous situation. So I think an example of how the made affirmative procedures perhaps been inappropriately used here, because there hasn't been due scrutiny in making sure that this was watertight to make sure that potential negative effects on the real public weren't avoided. Therefore, I'm minded to express a dissatisfaction with the use of this procedure.
Thank you, Paul Sweeney. And Jenny Minto, please.
Thank you, convener. I recognise some of what Paul Sweeney has described. However, I think we need to be cognisant of the evidence that we have just received from the Deputy First Minister with regards to Omicron and the research that was presented, which showed a huge increase of the virus. Really, as he said, the situation changed before our eyes in dramatic order. But I think we need to be aware of that. And from my perspective, I think the made affirmative procedure was the correct one to be using. Thank you
very much. Thank you, Jenny Minto. I don't know if Craig Hoy wishes to say something. Craig? I know it's cold in this building, but you appear to be frozen.
I don't want to rehearse the discussion that we just had with the Deputy First Minister, but I would agree with Graeme Simpson and Paul Sweeney that I think these instruments and the regulations they brought into effect would have benefited from that scrutiny, so that some of the unintended consequences that were negative wouldn't have occurred. And I think one of the other things in relation to it, the justification for bringing them in through the made affirmative route is that they had to be implemented in some cases the very next day. But again, we didn't have the justification from the government as to why the next day rather than a week's time or 10 days time would be the right moment to introduce those. So I think just on that basis, and given that Parliament was sitting when the measures were first introduced, I would support both Graeme Simpson and perhaps Paul Sweeney in suggesting that the affirmative route would have been the better route in these circumstances.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, okay, so 478, members agreed that 478 is more of a technical nature and certainly an issue which we don't need to vote on, but that we should vote on the four other instruments, 475, 496, 497 and 498. Are members agreed on that? I think we are. As the points are all similar, I suggest that we consider these four together, and that if we have a vote, then that will show the feeling of the committee in general. So, are members content with that approach, everyone? So, SSIs 475, 496, 497 and 498. And what we're going to do, because of the nature of how we're running the committee today, we're going to take each of the members, I'll call the names in alphabetical order, and members can simply answer whether they agree, do not agree or wish to abstain on this. So first of all, I'll call Craig Hoy, please. Craig Hoy, agree, not agree or abstain, please.
I do not agree.
Do not agree. Okay. Thank you. Jenny Minto, agree, not agree or abstain? Agree. Thank you. Graeme Simpson, agree, not agree or abstain?
Not agree.
Thank you. And Paul Sweeney, agree, not agree or abstain?
Not agree, convener.
Thank you. Okay. Right, I conclude with myself. I actually do agree, but therefore the clerks will put the result on the Blue Jeans chat function, because that's the correct procedure, and I will then read this out. Meanwhile, I can say that no points have been raised on SSIs 2021-465, 477. Is the committee content with these instruments? And we are. Okay, so that's fine. Thank you. Right. So we have the result of the division is 4, 2, against 3, abstentions 0. That's an SSIs 2021, 475, 496, 497 and 498. And therefore, not agreed is the result. Thank you there very much indeed, everyone, for that. And thank you to the clerking team for putting up with my procedures. Finally, under agenda item 7, we are considering instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. An issue has been raised on SSI 2021-468, the Act of Sedon Sheriff Appeal Court Rules 2021. This instrument makes provision for the procedure and forms to be used for appeals in the Sheriff Appeal Court. The instrument will replace the 2015 court rules. The committee identified an error in respect of an incorrect reference in Rule 33.1 to Section 44, brackets 3, of the Age of Criminal Responsibility Scotland Act 2019, which should have been to Section 46.3 of that Act. The Lord President's private office has committed to rectifying the error at the earliest appropriate opportunity. So does the committee agree to draw the instrument to the attention of Parliament on the general reporting ground in respect of this incorrect reference? We do agree. Okay. And can also ask, does the committee welcome the Lord President's private office having committed to rectifying the error at the earliest opportunity? Okay, no member has indicated that they are not content or that they wish to speak, so we are agreed. And I thank everyone for that. Okay. Bit confused now because I've got so much in front of me. Anyway, and I think we've passed that. Okay. I think I may have missed something here. Under agenda item 5, we're considering an instrument subject to the affirmative procedure. No points were raised in the draft Social Security Information Sharing Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. So is the committee content with this instrument? Thank everyone for that. Under agenda item 6, which I also missed, we are considering instruments subject to the negative procedure, and no points were raised on SSIs 2021 465 and 477. So is the committee content with these instruments? And thank you. No member has indicated that they are not content or that they wish to speak, so we are agreed. Further, under section 7, where I jumped on too quickly, under agenda item 7, we also had no points had been raised by members on SSIs 2021 464, 472, 474 and 480. So are the committee content with these instruments? There we are. No members indicated that they're not content or that they wish to speak, and so we are agreed, and I will move the committee into private. Thank you very much indeed.